Yo, Adam Saxon with Guy in a Cube, and in this video, I'm going to show you how you can use incremental refresh when you're using a native query, or even better yet, ODBC. Let's do this. If you're finding us for the first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date with all the videos from both Patrick and myself. All right, incremental refresh. I know Patrick's done a bunch of videos on this, but there was a scenario I had with a customer where they were using ODBC and certain things weren't folding from a query perspective, and they were getting timeouts when trying to refresh. The approach that was taken in that case was to use data flows and use incremental refresh on the data flows from a partitioning strategy. Wait, so with incremental refresh, we need query folding. ODBC, it wasn't folding for this particular operation. So how does that work? That's where we ended up going this native query plus incremental refresh route. And it worked. It allowed us to refresh the data in a timely fashion before hitting the 5-hour timeout in premium. I'm going to walk you through how we did it. One thing to note is that this applies equally to both Power BI data sets. So if you're doing this in Power BI desktop or data flows, in this case, I'm going to show you the data flows approach, but just know that there is one thing that I need to call out that is a difference, but I'll call that out when we get there. All right, enough of all this talking. Let's head over to my machine and see how this works. All right, I mentioned native query as well, and some of you may be going like, what the heck is native query? So let me just come down to SQL Server, show you that real quick. A native query means that I can actually supply my own SQL statement. So in this case, I can do like select whatever columns from a given table. The idea here is that you can supply your own query if you know it's gonna be more performant for the structure of your database. Now, one word of caution here is if you're gonna go this route, try and put as much of the transformations in this query as possible and limit what you're gonna do transformation wise from a Power BI desktop perspective. Things may not fold back, that could lead to performance problems. So just be aware of that. But I said we were gonna do data flows. So let's go over to the service and we are going to add a new data flow. In this case, I'm gonna be using SQL Server. I know I mentioned ODBC. Just know that ODBC allows you to supply native query as well. This operation works equally the same in both cases. So it's really no difference. It's just one, I can go directly to Azure SQL Database for what I'm gonna do in this video, or two, you can use the gateway and use ODBC. It's the same thing either way. Let's go and get SQL Server source. So I've got my server and database in here. Now what I wanna do is add in my T-SQL. So I'm just gonna pull everything from my internet sales table. I'm not gonna use a gateway because I'm just going directly to Azure SQL Database. Everything's good. Let's go to next. So here's our data. One thing I'm just going to do just to show you is I'm going to just do some fix ups here. I'm going to rename some columns. So we've got those columns renamed. We'll see that in our steps list. You also see it's red. I really like that the query folding indicators are in data flows. I really want that in Power BI desktop. So we can see here that the rename column step is not going to fold. That's because I'm using a native query. So this goes back to the point I said, try and put all of those items in the query that you're doing just to make sure that you're letting the database do what it needs to do. Okay, but this is my base query. Let me go and rename it also. And I'm just gonna save and close. Give it a name. All right, we are not gonna refresh yet because we don't have incremental refresh set up. And so this is kind of the order of operations. That piece is different between data flows and data sets. So on data flows, set up incremental refresh first, then go back and muck around with your range start, range end. In data sets, you set up the range start, range end first, and then set up incremental refresh. A couple orders of operation. So let's go ahead and we'll click this icon over on the far right of actions to set up incremental refresh. We're gonna do it on, and I'm gonna pick order date. This has to be a date time field. And so if you'd filtered the order date to just the date, you wouldn't have seen anything here. So let's go ahead and say 10 years, and I'll just say refresh rows from the last year. Looks good. Not gonna do detect data change, not gonna do any of that. So I'm just gonna save it. All right, again, don't refresh yet. Because technically, even though we set up incremental refresh, it's gonna do a full refresh on everything and it's not gonna fold back. So don't do that yet. So now we're gonna go back and edit the data flow. Now what you'll see here is we do have range start, range end parameters inside of my data flow now. And this was the incremental refresh that set all of that up. So it's good. And if we go and look at advanced editor, you'll see that it's actually doing this for the order date. So it's this line 4 right here. where it's actually setting up and applying the range start and range end to those items. Everything else is what we did. So the source, then the rename columns, and then it's doing this last step. And this was injected because of the incremental refresh. So now what I want to do is I'm actually not going to use the order date column for incremental refresh. I just use that to set this up. There's another column in here, the order date key, which I'm actually going to use that instead. You could use order date. It's up to you. It just depends on what you want to do. In this case, I'm just going to go with this integer value and go from there. What I want to do next is actually set up a function. This function is listed in the documentation for incremental refresh, and I'll have a link for that down in the description below of how to convert a date time to the integer. It's a neat technique that you can use. I think Patrick did this in one of his videos as well, where he showed how to use this. So what I'm going to do is just add a blank query, and we'll hit next. And we'll name it. So all this is going to do is take in a date time, and it'll convert that to an integer value. And like I said, you can just go copy and paste this out of the documentation. So now let's go back to my internet sales, go back to advanced editor, and we're going to do a couple things here. One, I'm going to get my start date. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to pass in my range start parameter, convert that into an integer, and put it in my start date. We'll call it a variable. And then we'll do the same thing for range end. Now, this is where the cool thing is going to come in. So what I'm going to do is copy and paste this like a good cooking show. What we're going to do is that same T-SQL query that we have, we're going to add in the actual where clause in the T-SQL statement and pass in the start date and end date. These are integers, so I don't need to escape them. They're not a string, so that's fine. But basically, I'm just stuffing this into the native query. This is the magic. So I'm actually injecting the range start, range end into that native query. And so that's actually what's handling the partition information. Basically, I'm doing my own query folding effectively, and I'm stuffing that into the T-SQL. So then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this query parameter, and I'm going to replace the actual query with that item. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab the next step, which is the rename columns, and I'm just going to add that in for that final step. Technically, I could just replace this whole thing with the rename columns. It doesn't matter, because this is what's handling the partition information. All right, and that's it. Let's hit OK. That should work. All right, and we'll save and close. No errors. That's good. Now we refresh. So I'm just going to say refresh now. We'll go ahead and close out of this. And we can see down below here that we are refreshing. So this part could take a few minutes, depending on your data source, how much data is there and what it's actually going to go do. In the customer example I was referring to, when we set this up, it went from 5 hours to, like, I want to say 2.5, 3 hours on the refresh, which was great. Another thing I want to call out about this approach, I mentioned that I'm kind of injecting these parameters into my query statement. Just be aware that SQL injection is a real thing, and you need to be mindful of that. In this case, the range start, range end parameters, those are auto supplied by the service. The service itself is going to be passing in the values for that item that are actual date times. Just know that you're going to be putting this into a query statement, so know what it is that's being put in and do some testing and validation around that. Be very careful about strings, like if you're actually injecting a string into your query statement, because that could have some really bad effects. So just be mindful of that. All right, our refresh completed. Now, one thing I want to show you, because you may be sitting there, well, okay, you did that, but how do I know that it worked? If we go into our refresh history, we'll see that it completed. I'm going to download this. This is going to be a CSV file. And if I just open that CSV file, it's actually going to show me the partition names that were created for this given data flow. And we can see the table name itself and those partitions and that they completed. So that was really cool. And you can see all the partitions that were set up for each year. And then you can also see the rows that were processed. And we can see that the rows are different for each partition and how much time those partitions took. That's bananas. So it actually worked. It went through each partition. It injected the range start, range end the way that I wanted it to, even though I'm using a native query. And technically, even if I was using ODBC, all of it works. And it just pulls that data in, sets up those partitions nicely. It would do the same thing from a Power BI data set perspective as well. All right, what do you think about this approach? Is this something you've already known about? Is it something that blew your mind? Let me know down in the comments below. We want to hear it. If you like this video, be sure to hit that big thumbs up button. Smash it if you so desire. If it's your first time here, hit that subscribe button. And as always, from both Patrick and myself, thank you so much for watching. Keep being awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.